It sounded terrible because the one was flat and the other one was sharp.
The other one was sharp, so they were both yelling at each other.
They're like, one of us is wrong, it's not me.
Okay.
Now, that being said, it was a good string to throw because I don't.
Okay, so living
it's not
really
used
well.
Much anyway, but.
On the chorus, is there any harmony that either one of you guys. Actually, no, I was doing harmony.
Yeah.
Never mind. All right. I want harmony because if I have to sing melody, it's hard. I want that. Oh, I'll buy it. Okay.
Nope. Let's try that again. What is wrong with you today?
If you just want to do this instrumentally, we can.
That's kind of what I'm thinking.
We could. Yeah, I'm not as familiar with it.
What?
Do you want Jerry to play it?
No, playing it isn't the
Do you just want Jerry to do
it?
What
are you trying to tell me?
I just know you're struggling a bit this morning.
No, I'm feeling good now. I don't. Listen, it's been a.
Do you want Jerry to do it? I don't mean it like that. I just know you're struggling.
Do you want Jerry to do it? Listen, I don't mean it in any bad way. I just know you're feeling rough today.
You need to shape up, or he's just stealing your entire job.
I know, that's the problem. Give me something.
Yeah, he's the adult of the group this morning. He's the driver. He's leading songs.
Really is taking over my job. I'm okay with it. Eternal home, but for now I walk this broken world. You walked it first.
This is good.
You know our pain.
Yeah, don't push it, keep it soft.
You so hope can rise again up from the grave.
And if you do that, I'll sing with you on the chorus.
Or the shot. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me fall, and don't let go, walk with me, and never leave, ever close, God, abide with me. There in the night, Gethsemane, before the cross, before the nail, overwhelmed, alone you pray, met us in our suffering and bore our shame. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me fall, and don't let go, walk with me, and never leave, ever close, God, abide with me. just gonna do an interlude instead of that bridge. That's kind of what I'm thinking. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall. And don't let go. Walk with me. And never leave, ever close. God, abide with me. One more time. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall. And don't let go. Walk with me. And never leave, ever close, God, abide with me.
You know, you really don't need to do that one more time, because nobody's really going to be singing.
No, I know, but we normally didn't do it before, so I was, it was more of a guidance to keep
that
build going.
Yeah, so for
going.
That bridge, just do like a...
I was just going to do a little...
8, 16 measures of...
Something.
Yeah, something, and then we'll just watch you. And
did it sound okay? Did it sound
too
strange?
Oh, I thought it sounded great. No, I think as long as you keep the verses mellow,
okay,
then you don't have to make the chorus as big.
I also dropped it down a little bit.
So we're doing Abide With Me, You Are My King, Blessed Be Your Name, Living Hope, 4 songs?
Yes.
Yeah, run that order by me.
Nothing, we'll just do an instrumental.
Okay.
Abide With Me, You Are My King, Blessed Be Your Name, Living Hope.
Oh, perfect. La-di-da.
I believe. Let me check and make sure, but I'm pretty sure. Oh, today's Rose Kenny's birthday. Good for her.
Remind me to not text her.
Yes, that's the right word. Perfect. So I can do Abide With Me, I Should Be Okay. You Are My King, y'all want to take it. Sounds really good, and y'all do it, not a problem. Blessed be your name.
Yeah, we got it. We got it. We should do that one on Wednesday.
We should do that one on Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
We need to get this guy on mic more often.
We do need to get this guy on
mic.
And
I'm not saying we need to give you a mic less just at the moment.
Listen,
I'm
I was on board until you tried to patronize.
I'm trying to be complimentary, and you're like...
Well, I'm not used to this kind of complimentary. This is strange.
I understand your pain. You're not always like this, so we'll work through it.
You're not always
and you're the one.
You knew it. There's also a little bit of an element of the fact that I haven't warmed up in
maybe that's a good
a
thing
week and
warm,
a half.
Though.
So it is, I mean, there was probably...
Keep working on this, but I'm like, if I get the other,
it's not even the strength, it's just the accuracy. You're able to control your pointer finger a lot better.
Of course, if we condense it, you'd probably be on acoustic. I could play keyboard, you could play electric.
not.
I didn't even think about it.
I'm gonna be the guy who invited the rival minister.
I can't do that.
Yeah, I danced better than you.
But you did not dance better than
me.
Listen,
I
was killing.
I
was killing. Tell him I killed him. Tell. Lying that I killed
him.
You did okay. You're better than him.
Ask Lily. We were. Dude, I had the. When you walked around the circle,
yeah.
Like, I had that thing down. Like, I might. Like, it was perfect.
You, like, freaked out, and then you kind of just trailed behind whatever girl was leading you around the circle.
Yeah.
Yeah. Other than that, I thought you did okay.
No, I had that one.
Other than
that,
when you
had
to
do
it with Faith, she'd, like, drag you around that circle.
Yeah. I think she's 21, 22.
That would explain why she could dance so well. Well, better than the actual freshman. But I knew it was a freshman.
Better than the actual.
It was that girl with like the black and it was like a black shirt with the bright colored letters and glasses.
What was her name?
I didn't ask.
Who?
She was the one in our group that was kind of lost. It was her and then the two guys in our group other than you.
Like,
I wish I would
have gotten the kid, like, when we did the sides do it and the heads do it, like, he was the one I had to grab first, and I had no, of course, I had no problem, like, let's go.
Yeah.
But okay, he seemed pretty nice, yeah. And the
no,
girl was pretty nice, too.
Lily
was
my partner for that.
Oh, that's probably good.
Yeah, apparently, you're an intern. Like, a lot of people just held their hands out like this. Like, I was told by one of my good friends who's like an amazing dancer, like when I watch him, he goes like this. I don't know why.
That makes sense though. That would be easier for the
That's a good
It's easier for the girl to hold on to.
Yeah.
And it looks better.
It does
instead
look
of instead of this. This
instead of
this.
Because then
better.
You're kinda like across each other's bodies.
Because he'll go from this to he'll grab her hand and go up like this, and so her arm is like this, and they'll walk in a circle and look at each other like through their arm.
That's cool.
Yeah, like that's where I learned that, and nobody told me not to do it. So I'm like, okay, it's like it looks like it hurts your arm. I'm like, no, it's easier on you.
What?
How'd you do it?
It would have been your pointer finger.
The upper stuff is easier than the
Yeah.
Honestly, it's just like a second nature. Like, yeah. You just add it out.
See, that's the thing. I like learning guitar and I used my pinky, so now, like, not using it would be weird for me. But it's probably good.
And you just kind of figure out what patterns to hit.
Yeah.
It's like that little... That's just...
And again, once you learn it, like, it just becomes like a second nature.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, you just add it out of instinct.
Because you do that too, especially on the D chord.
I do. That little run back and forth.
Yeah.
It's just like one of those things that you
once
do.
Once you get it, it's like, how could you not? Like,
yeah.
It's pretty enough and easy enough. No, I say that now.
Or like, I'll alternate, like if I'm doing B minor does it, but if I do C, if you alternate your middle finger up and down. So like.
See, I need to like do the shapes of my fingers without looking like I'm like,
that's the problem, is like I'll be bragging and I'm like,
how would you
doing that?
Like when it's the bass note?
Yeah, so
how are you?
So, memento.
Poor favor.
So you do like
I am ripping up my nail cutter.
So you do like a I guess it works with B minor too, but like you can or so then, like, if you have, like, in Abide With Me, you have this, like, the...
We're so subtle, you don't even really
know. A lot of times, this finger is going to be the bass, or this finger, and the middle finger, you can get away with, like, pulling off and hammering on it.
Because
mm-hmm.
Really as long
good.
As you have a bass note and root note, you can kind of throw whatever.
Yeah.
Within reason, whatever note. Those are usually the most important. Like on piano, that's usually what makes or breaks the chord. Like, is it sad? Is it happy?
Right.
Yeah.
Anxious? Yeah. Like if the, like. It's just like a super easy, fun run. I learned it was "Here Comes the Sun." When I was learning that,
that
and I'm
one
like.
Would have it.
Or here comes it was it wasn't here comes the sun.
Yeah, it is.
Well, Here Comes the Sun does it too, but it's also in American Pie in the end, like the end of the verse where. It, if it doesn't sound too strange, if it when we did
so.
It before, if it doesn't sound
it
too strange.
Fine.
I don't think so. I think the way you did it where it's like we're kind of just standing up here and pitching.
Okay. It's up to you. I can just do an instrumental if that sounds better, if that would work easier.
Yeah, I'd say like don't even treat it like a song, just treat it like that. Just like kind of play through it.
I just
mean
just up there being special.
I just mean like not
you're
reading a song,
you're
just playing.
You're just playing.
Yeah, you're just playing that song. I'm like taking everything that I say and like assuming that it's something that's attractive.
Well, in my defense, 96% of the things you tell me are.
But the other 4%.
The other 4% are really kind and sweet, and then the other 96 is making fun of my tasties with words that I used for my hot water this morning. Which you didn't comment on, and I was impressed.
Did they charge you for it?
They did.
How much?
Like 79 cents.
What they charge you?
79 cents for my Casey's cup of hot water.
Nice.
You know, I'm sure we have
hot water. Well, I probably didn't get myself hot water too. Here we are.
Didn't
cold water all the time. How is it different than cold water? No, Olin. It's unnecessary.
There's a reason for it.
It's environmentally unnecessary. Well, yeah, then you have like lava tubes and everything. Like, you have, there are places that exist.
Yeah, Yellowstone. You have like.
Okay.
Well, that, but then they also have areas where there's like wooden walkways, but you're almost surrounded by.
They're not like small. I think they're just smaller than normal Aussies are.
Yeah.
still have to update it with it. I just do it all myself.
Thank you.
This one's all you, boss. I don't know. I'm not gonna sing it.
You don't know it at all?
No.
You got it.
I know.
She knows it. She'll carry
it.
Well,
that's good, because I'm gonna need
you
some help.
Sing.
I'm gonna need some help here, folks.
I really hope I don't cry.
You mean
I don't.
I was gonna say, you're good for like this.
If I do, it's gonna break into a growl, because I will cover it with that. I'm doing my best not to do that. It's hard. I'm doing my best not to do it. Because it does make it a lot easier.
I don't go super hard on that one.
It makes it a lot easier if I do it, but I'm trying not to.
I have a home. Eternal home. But for now, I walk this broken world. You walked it first. You know our pain. You show hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall. And don't let go. Walk with me. And never leave. Ever close. God, abide with me. There in the night, Gethsemane, before the cross, before the nails, overwhelmed, alone you pray, you met us in our suffering and bore our shame. Abide with me, abide with me. Don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me, and never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me. Abide with me, abide with me. Don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me, and never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall. And don't let go. Walk with me. And never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me.
Want to welcome any visitors we might have, and it's just good to have all of you here this morning. And we invite you to stay for coffee and rolls following our sermon today. I have a fair number of announcements I'd like to highlight today. First of all, we're just so glad to have We the Many back. Let's give them a round of applause. They are such a blessing. And we're looking forward to having them lead us in song this morning. And then, as you may have noticed in your bulletins, we're going to hand out Bibles to the fourth graders. And we're looking forward to doing that. We'll do that after the Sunday school comes up and sings. And we're looking forward to having them sing for us. So, again, they'll come up and sing. And then I want to give a special thank you to Nate Anderson and Brad Bousquet. You know, on Election Day, Tuesday, they both took a day off. Excuse me. They both took a day off, and they worked all day, and it was kind of a miserable day. It rained in the morning, and they got 3/4 of our front steps reassembled. And let's give them a round of applause, shall we? It was hard work, and it was neat to just to see them volunteer their time in that way and work so hard. We so appreciate what they did. And then, you may note we have flowers at the front of church today. The flowers on the left are in memory of Arla Jean Landholm. Arla passed away a week ago last evening. Her service was here on Thursday, and we hope you will continue to keep Arla Jean family in your prayers at this time. And then you may note there's some roses and carnations on the altar on the right-hand side. These are donated by an anonymous person, but I'd like to read the names of those for whom they're given in memory. Bonnie Goodrich, Millie Sandquist, Betty Rogers, Nancy Poppy, Lois Messerschmidt, Bernice Pearson, Tootie Webster, Marilyn Burrish, Betty Holmes, Pat Mosman, Pat Segrin, Melvin and Margaret Segrin, Lee and Madonna Schleider, Gail Taylor, and Dave Pearson. We remember all of these people, and we're so grateful for these flowers in honor of them this morning and memory of them. I think that covers everything I wanted to mention today. And as always, if I think of something later, I'll bring it to your attention. At this time, I'd like you to arise, and we'll join We the Many in our opening song.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. You 'cause you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Amazing love, how can it be? You, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I
Father, we praise you in your mighty character. You are our creator, our comforter in times of need, our healer when we are broken, and our mighty and sovereign King. Today we bring our voices, hearts, and hands as we praise you. Thank you for this country, the United States of America. You have formed us into a nation, created freedoms that are unique in the world, and enriched us. Thank you for the land where we live and the men and women who served to preserve those freedoms. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. He willingly gave up his life for us. His grace-filled gift of becoming the final sacrifice for all enables us to approach you with confidence. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the Holy Spirit, a piece of yourself within us. Through the work of the Spirit, we are empowered to serve your glory, not our own. We thank you for the privilege of prayer. You have created a way to talk to you, and you promise to hear us. Help us to quiet ourselves, to listen and accept your answers. Lord, sometimes our world seems crazy. We know you are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Help us to live in the knowledge of your perfect plan and your control over every detail. Build our confidence and trust in you. We ask for a seeking heart in each of us. Make us love you more deeply and completely every day. Fill us with your presence. We ask you to bless our ministries. We bring your precious word to children and adults through Bible study, Sunday school, confirmation, and youth group activities. We ask for your special blessing on all teachers, helpers, and volunteers. Give them the enthusiasm, stamina, and build a love in their hearts to the people they serve. We ask for your eyes this week. Let us see those in our community who need a helping hand, a kind word, or a simple smile. Show us your presence in our day-to-day living. Guide us until we are back in this worship fellowship again. To you be all the glory. Amen.
Thank you, Bailey, so much. We're so delighted when our young people lead part of our service in prayer. Bailey's also going to read our scripture today, but at this time, we'd like to invite our Sunday school to come forward, and they're going to sing for us.
Good morning. Thought maybe I'd talk before I am out of breath. So I guess today we've got a couple songs we're going to sing. Now we have started on our Christmas music downstairs. So it's super duper important that the kids come to Sunday school every Sunday so we can get on that Christmas music, because before you know it, we're going to be singing it. The next thing is Tess was able to put all of our Christmas music on the Facebook page of the church. So the moms that know how to do this, download it so you can listen to it in your car. Because last year we found out a lot of people don't have CD players in their cars anymore because they're driving newer vehicles than I am. So we will do some CD player or some CDs for some kids, whoever need them. But the other ones, if the parents would download that music, because we don't have very many Sundays left before we really have to get on it. And I don't want to disappoint anybody because we've had such nice programs. So anyway, so that's all I have today. And our fourth graders get Bibles today, which is a great celebration. So, all righty. Thank you.
Thank you, Jill. Thank you, Cindy, so much. It's just good to see all of you here today, and I'm going to sneak out front. I just have a real short message for you this morning, but today I want to ask you, because in just a little bit, Bailey is going to read a Bible passage. We just sang about the Bible, right? And she's going to read a Bible passage from the book of Nehemiah. And Nehemiah lived during the Old Testament times, and Nehemiah was, in a sense, in captivity. He'd been led with the people of Judah to a land called Babylon and then Persia. But you know what? He worked for the king of Persia. And the Persian king liked Nehemiah. He was a servant. Nehemiah was a servant. But you could tell the king liked Nehemiah. And one day, you'll have to listen to this. One day, Nehemiah came to the king to serve him. And he was sad. And the king asked him why. And he told how his people, who had started to go back to the Holy Land, the land of Israel, hadn't been able to rebuild the walls around Jerusalem. And Nehemiah wanted to help with this. And so when Nehemiah responded, he did this first. And listen to this very carefully when Bailey reads it. It says, I prayed to my God. And you know what it means? It means he whispered a prayer to God. Because I don't think Nehemiah stood and right in front of the king, prayed, and then talked to the king. Meaning, he prayed a silent prayer. And you don't have to raise your hands, but how many of you have ever prayed a silent prayer before? Meaning, no one knows that you were praying but you yourself. Yeah, I hope you all do. And maybe sometimes it's when you're worried about something, or maybe you're thankful about something, or maybe you know you've done something wrong and you ask forgiveness, and you just say a silent prayer to God, whisper a prayer to him. And you know what? It's a great way to live. That whenever you think of something that you're worried about, or you want to be forgiven for, or you're thankful for, no one even needs to know you're praying. You can just whisper a silent prayer to God. And you know what happens as we do that a lot? God becomes our best friend. And he becomes the one we just love talking to every day. And I guess the message I'm going to leave with you this morning is I hope all of you, all the time, whisper little silent prayers to God. When you're happy, when you're sad, whatever the occasion. And they don't need to be long, just a sentence. Just, oh, Lord, thank you. Oh, Lord, forgive me. Oh, Lord, help me. And I hope all of you enjoy talking to God, even when no one knows you're doing it. But God knows, doesn't he? Because he's listening. So that's the message I'm going to leave with you today. Now, we're not going to go back quite yet because we're going to get, speaking of the B-I-B-L-E, I'm going to sneak through here. Speaking of the B-I-B-L-E, we're going to give the Bible to our fourth graders this morning. And when I read your name, you can come and get it. And how about Adele? Is Adele here? Okay. We'll get this to her at a later date. Let's see. Rachel. Rachel here? Hi, Rachel. There you go. And let's see. Clara. Clara. Hi, Clara. And Jovi. Is Jovi here? We'll get this to Jovi later. Oh, is she right next to you? Oh, okay. Let's see, Lillian. Here you go, Lillian. Let's see, Ava. There you go, Ava. Ivy. Ivy, this is for you. Let's see. I think we've just got one more to give out today. Landon. Landon isn't here. Okay. You know what? The good news is we're going to get these Bibles to these other ones in Sunday school, but we're so delighted to give them to you today. I know you're going to receive some instruction on how to use them, and we're so delighted about doing that, and I think they're going to take some pictures. I'll get out of the way so I'm not in that picture. Well, you can edit me out later. And the good news is we have something for everybody, not just the fourth graders. You all know what we have. We have, well, a straw. We have some candy. Everybody take some candy today, and then you're certainly free to go back to your seats. Just a brief note, we're not going to do a pay it forward today, but I know I mentioned a few Sundays ago, but if you didn't catch it, last month our pay it forward, we raised $1,000 for the food bank, and someone matched it with another $1,000. So our giving last month provided $2,000 for the food bank in Oakland. So, we won't do one today, but we so appreciate when you do it. And let's give these young people a round of applause. Oh, you're welcome. Okay, and next month when we do it, it'll be for the miracle on Oakland Avenue. And we'll give you some more details then. By the way, won't that be our Christmas program? I think it will, so. Yes. And just to let you know here, I tell you, I thought I had more than enough candy today. But, oh, yes. One piece, everybody. There you go. You're welcome. Decisions, decisions. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's a hard decision. I know which one I'd pick in there. Yes. Thank you for not picking the one I wanted. Uh-oh. She's changing her mind. Okay. Well, once again, let's give these young people a round of applause, shall we?
For this scripture, we will be reading verses from chapter 6 and 2 of Nehemiah. In the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was served him, I carried the wine and gave it to the king. Now I have never been sad in his presence before. So the king said to me, "Why is your face sad since you're not sick? This can only be sadness of the heart." Then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, "May the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city of the place my ancestor's grave lies waste and its gates have been destroyed by fire?" Then the king said to me, "What do you request?" So I prayed to the God of heaven. Then I said to the king, "If it pleases the king and if your servant has found favor with you, I ask that you send me to Judah, to the city of my ancestor's grave, so that I may rebuild it." The king said to me, "How long will you be gone, and when will you return?" So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a date. So the wall was finished on the 25th day of the month Elul in 52 days.
Thank you, Bailey, so much. And again, we appreciate all of our young people. We love it when anybody reads, but we especially enjoy it when a young person reads for us. And in Bailey's case, also led us in prayer. But let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we just simply pray that as we continue our sermon series that we do on the second weekend of every month, as we continue that sermon series on wisdom, wisdom for living from the book of Proverbs, you will make it living and real in our hearts today, everything we talk about. And we will leave here freshly equipped to do well in life with your wisdom that comes from above. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I think many of you have seen a movie. It came out a long time ago, but perhaps you've caught it in reruns on television or the Turner Movie Classic Channel or so on. It was the movie 9 to 5. How many of you remember that movie or have seen it in some way? I see some hands going up. If you remember that movie, it was about three working women. And they go into work every day, but they can never live out their full potential because they had kind of a chauvinistic boss who, in his mind, all they were good for is getting him coffee, doing those traditional things, and again, they were frustrated. They knew they had talents. They knew they had abilities, and in that sense, they would have loved work if they could use them. They would have felt fulfilled. But again, they felt held back by their boss. By the way, played by an actor named Dabney Coleman, who, if you remember him at all, always managed, and by the way, this movie was a comedy, always managed to play scoundrels in kind of a lovable, humorous way. In fact, I can't remember a movie he was in where he didn't make me laugh. But anyway, and then of course, we know, if you remember, one of the women in this movie was Dolly Parton. And she also, of course, would sing the theme song to this movie, and I'm sure almost all of you have heard this song, but we're going to play at least part of this song this morning. We'll see if it works. If it not, doesn't, we'll adjust. But we're going to hear a clip of 9 to 5 and see some of the lyrics.
Tumble out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen. Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets the traffic starts jumping. With folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living. Barely getting by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind. Step on the boss man's ladder, but you got dreams he'll never
well,
take away.
Yes, I think we can just slowly fade it out.
In the same boat with a lot of your friends.
Part of me would love to hear the rest of that song. I'm tapping my foot. The good news is, if you like it, I'm sure you can download it from, is it Spotify or Apple Music or whatever. But of course, the words of the song kind of express the theme of that movie. First of all, she poured herself a cup of ambition. Maybe some of you did that this morning. Before you came to church, a cup of ambition to kind of get up. And then she would sing about it, and the movie would portray that she had talents, she wanted to use them, but she was kind of kept down. And there was frustration. Well, I wanted to talk about this movie and show this clip because I think in many ways it's quite biblical. You know, I think all of us feel and know that God has given us various talents and abilities. And we want to use them. And I think all of us also, when we work, at times feel frustrated. And you know, the Bible speaks of all this. It's at the very beginning. It speaks in Scripture of how God made us to do things. We read in Genesis 1 and 2, God creates our world and he puts Adam and Eve in the garden. What? Do you remember? To tend and care for it. They were given a job. Adam even named the animals. And the Bible says they were made in God's image. An incredibly deep subject, but I think we catch an idea what it means to be made in God's image. But part of that is simply you sense God creates our world. He makes us in his image. He puts us in charge of it. To enjoy it and use it, but to also to take care of it. He gives us a job, and in a sense, he wants us to continue to create, to do things, to take his creation, which he's made, which was amazing. But in some strange way, I mean, it can't be improved, but maybe on one level, continue to create with the resources of his creation. Can I give you a little silly example? How many love summer tomatoes? I think we all do, right off the vine, just tastes so great. You know, they're from Central America, and they were edible, but they didn't taste good, they were bitter. So the tomatoes you eat today were bred up. They were bred up by people, using their creative powers to take something in God's creation and amplify it, make it even better in a sense and enjoy it even more. Or we see these beautiful flowers at the front of church. Obviously, everything originally grew wild. But isn't it great to see flowers in an arrangement? as we, made in the image of God, continue to create. In a sense, we are called for purpose, for mission, to create, to work. But we also read in Genesis 3 that when sin entered our world, it explicitly states this, work would now no longer always be fulfilling. Work at times would be a burden. It speaks of sweat of the brow, and even mentions a person, in a sense, if you farm, now there's going to be weeds and thistles in the fields. Work isn't going to be as fulfilling as it was. It'll at times be a struggle. You might say, when our world became broken and fallen, and sin and sickness, suffering and death entered it, along came frustration. Frustration that can come to work. So it's not without reason we've invented Murphy's Law, right? And how many of you have ever used these words if you were working on something, be it something at home or something on the job? Something doesn't go well, and you think, that's right, Murphy's Law. If something can go wrong, it will, right? It's just what Scripture speaks of. It's what Scripture speaks of. And so today, we're going to look at work a little bit as we look at the book of Proverbs. And just to review a little bit, a month ago, we began this study in the book of Proverbs, this incredibly practical advice that God gives us in that book. And do you remember, and it should be in your bulletin today, do you remember how we looked at and how it states in chapter 1 of Proverbs that Solomon wrote these Proverbs specifically for parents to teach their children so they could be successful and safe in life? So they could be successful and safe in life. That's why these Proverbs were written. In a sense, they were written for young people. So they could be successful and safe. And last week, we sort of began it. We looked at our theme, again, which is Proverbs for Living. We looked at our theme verse, reverence for the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And we looked at how reverence includes love, awe, and fear. The sense that God is above it. Basically, it's saying, the beginning of wisdom is considering God in everything you do and allowing Him to be in charge of your life and be the Lord of your life. That's the beginning of wisdom, coming to faith in Him, Jesus Christ as one Savior and Lord. And then we looked at a definition of wisdom. Wisdom is taking God's word, the Scriptures, and applying them to my life. That's wisdom. How wonderful to hear them. How wonderful to hear them and think, how nice. But wisdom is hearing them and thinking, I want what I just heard to be true in my life. I want to live the way God just instructed me to live. Lord, I whisper a prayer to you. Help me to do that. And we live these instructions. And I'm excited about all that we have. And next time we're going to look at speech. Being wise in the use of our tongue. Haven't we seen our society and culture disintegrate because people can't control their tongues? And you watch the news and all you see are insults hurled from one person to another person, from one group to another group, and you think the civility of our society has begun to unravel because people can't control their tongues, their speech. And we're going to look at that next time. But today we're going to look at what Proverbs has to say about work. And you should have received a handout. We're going to go through this very quickly. I'm always aware of the time. By the way, according to the clock, I'm already past. It's 11:07. I don't think it's ever been set back. But let's look at point one. We should have balance in our work life because we are fallen, our lives of work and rest can get out of balance. The Bible says sometimes we can work too much. You know, I heard a sermon one time where the minister said, if we're not busy enough to stay busy 7 days or 6 days a week, we're busier than God intended us to be. But if we're so busy that we're busy 7 days a week, we're busier than God intended us to be. God rested after His creative work. He rested on the seventh day. And how important to keep our work life in balance. And we can work too much. How important to allow time to just relax do things we want to do, enjoy God, and on a day like today, spend time with Him. Spend time with Him. Keep it in balance. We can work too much. B. C. Because we're fallen, we can also be lazy. Can I be honest with you? I feel that streak in me at times. We can be lazy. We may not live out God's calling and accomplish things. This is where the book of Proverbs comes in. All through Proverbs, Solomon, God through Solomon, speaks and encourages people to work, to not be lazy. And so Proverbs puts the accent there of not being lazy. And it could lead to our second point. We should work hard and not be lazy. And we've got a couple quotes here from Proverbs. If you are lazy, you will never get what you are after. But if you work hard, you will get a fortune. I don't think it means you'll be rich. I think it's just meaning you're going to do okay in life. You work hard, you're going to do okay in life. Show up at work, do what they ask you to do. You're going to do okay in life. Next verse. By the way, I used a New Modern Version. The King James Version of this next verse is quite blunt. In the King James Version, it says this: look to the ant, you sluggard. But this is a more, I guess, modern version. Lazy people should learn a lesson from the way ants live. They store up their food during the summer, getting ready for winter. How long will the lazy man keep lying around? When is he ever going to get up? I'll just take a short nap, he says. But while he sleeps, poverty will attack him like an armed robber. Can I give a little history here? You know, 2 weeks ago, we celebrated the Reformation. And did you know one of the themes of the Reformation was Scripture alone? The themes of the Reformation were grace alone. We're saved by grace alone, through faith, by putting our trust in Jesus to love us, forgive us, be our Savior and Lord. And then we base that faith on the teachings of Scripture alone. Can I share with you a byproduct of that third theme of Reformation? The countries of Northern Europe, where the Reformation had its center, and also Britain, because they felt lay people could read the Bible, because they felt that through the Holy Spirit, an average person could read the Bible and understand it, they would launch a desire to have all the masses learn to read. Modern literacy comes from the Reformation. You may not have heard that, but it did. In the 1500s, there was such a desire for these peoples and countries in Northern Europe, for just average lay people to be able to read the Bible, not just priests, not just pastors, but the average person. They would launch, not programs really, but there'd be a movement to teach everybody to read. And you know what it was to do? To read the Bible. Modern literacy is a product of the people of the Reformation wanting everybody to read so they could read the Bible. Can I share something with you? It worked. It worked. Because the average lay people would read their Bible, and by the way, they'd read Proverbs, where it would speak of the importance of working hard, being productive, finding fulfillment in it, enjoying it. And you know what the result was? Northern Europe and then America became the richest areas in the world. The Reformation, through emphasizing literacy, people reading their Bibles and reading these passages, launched our modern era of prosperity. And people would work hard. And the result was Northern Europe and eventually the United States and Canada became the richest nations on earth from Proverbs. No kidding. I'm not making it up. Point three. Good work habits are built upon discipline. A. Have you ever made yourself do something you did not feel like doing, but you knew it needed to be done? This is discipline. Here it says, the plans of the disciplined or diligent lead to profit. Disciplined or diligent hands make a man rich. or at least help a person to do well. And great Proverbs. Again, I love being a minister, but every now and then I make myself do something even though I don't feel like doing it. Sometimes some weeks are busier than others. This past week, we honored Arla Jean, but it meant an extra sermon, which I didn't mind, but I know I worked into the evening one night on that. And in a way, I didn't feel like it, but I did it, although I felt rewarded in then sharing that at her service. Interesting stuff, built upon discipline. You know, I don't know how many of you have read books about some of these things, but I have a book at home, and it's entitled Outliners by Malcolm Gladwell. And he shares about a man named Bill Joy, and of course, Bill Gates, we've heard of them, and how they ushered in the modern era of modern computing. In fact, Bill Joy developed the coding that's still used today. It's called Unix for computers. But you know what? He lived and breathed computers the minute they came out. Even as a teenager, he'd go to the local University of Michigan, the only computer around, and he'd live there, basically. Bill Gates, ditto in Washington. And this author would write, they probably spent 10,000 hours doing coding and working before they ever developed their companies. The Beatles. I'm a Beatles groupie. We went to hear Paul McCartney last spring. But he points out that before the Beatles became famous in 1964, they had played in Hamburg almost every day of the week. In fact, often weeks on end, long stretches of time. Usually bands play a couple hours. They would play 8-12 hours in a row. Just music became ingrained in them. It always ran through their heads. They could play their instruments without thinking. And he estimates they had played 10,000 hours, more than most bands play in their entire careers. They had played 10,000 hours before they ever became famous. Discipline. Discipline. Good work habits are built on discipline. 4, good work habits are usually formed in the home and demonstrated by parents. Son, pay attention to what your father and mother tell you. Their teaching can improve your character. Can I share with you that if we want children to be successful, they learn discipline and good work habits at home? About 2 weeks ago, I attended a seminar on poverty up at the high school. 7 o'clock on a Thursday night, a woman who works for the state of Nebraska came in an educational department. I felt kind of sorry for her because Rusty Drescher and I were the only ones who showed up. But you know what she shared? It was a little more nuanced than this. But you know what she talked about? And the whole thing was on the origins of poverty. You know what the origins of poverty mostly are? There's exceptions. Young people who grow up without a home. What determines whether one succeeds in life or is impoverished more than anything else is the home one grows up in. And if one doesn't have parents that encourage a young person to study, or if you have a parent that perhaps doesn't work, him or herself, if you have a parent that has addiction problems, if there's emotional strife, obviously, we know this almost by common sense, more than likely those children will be impoverished. And then, of course, the goal of the seminar was to think of ways perhaps schools and even churches could come in and help fill the gap a little bit, to provide support systems for these young people. Discipline and good work habits are formed in the home. 5, we can feel good about what we accomplish at work. The reason in Nehemiah we jumped 6 chapters to chapter 6 for the final verse is because you heard in the children's sermon, the king allowed him to go back, he rolled up his sleeves, he organized the efforts, and Nehemiah, through his organizational efforts and sweat, they rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem in 52 days, and you sense Nehemiah felt great about it. Let's look at the final one. We live in a state of grace. Sometimes our life may get out of balance. We may work too hard, not allow enough time to be with God and just relax and enjoy things. Other times, we may think, you know what, I'll put it off until tomorrow. And by the way, I do that. But the good news is we live in a state of grace. And when we sense our lives are out of balance in one direction or another, we can say, Lord, recenter me, forgive me, help me to be the person you want me to be. Help me to be the person you want me to be. And then, very importantly, be here. We don't compare ourselves with others. It's not my job to force others to have good work habits or look down on them if they don't. Remember a few weeks ago we had a message? It's not my job to change other people. I can't do it. Only God can do it. My job is to change me with God's help. And so it's not my job to go around and think, why? What? How? I wish that person would get off their rear and work as hard as I do. No. We just want to work hard for our Lord. We don't earn our salvation that way. That's a gift. It's a gift through faith in Jesus as our Savior. But as an outpouring of this, we want to be all God intended us to be. Use our gifts, talents, and abilities to find fulfillment in working hard. And then also allow time to be with God and to relax and enjoy what he's given us. But we don't change other people. See, if someone is struggling with not having good work habits, we can, with their permission, kind of like the school seminar, in Christian love, seek to help them develop good work habits and be the person that God wants them. Maybe we offer, talk to the school and we offer to do some tutoring. But it's with their permission, not thinking, well, what a loser. No, we think, wow, with their permission, can God use me to help them to be the person God wants them to be? We've raced through it, but I hope you've been blessed as we've looked at this incredible practical advice from the book of Proverbs. I'm excited about all the things we're going to talk about in the future, in future months, enough that we may add a few things just on a non-youth Sunday towards the end of the school year. Lord, we come to you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for its relevance. We thank you that it's so practical. Not only talks about faith and relationships, the most important things in life, but things like work. Things like our speech patterns. So many other things. Lord, may we be the people you want us to be. With our work, leisure, life in balance. As we trust in you, Lord Jesus, as our Savior and Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Blessed be your name in a land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, the walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name, the sun shining down on me, and the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, on the road marked with suffering, there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to pray. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, well, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, well, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's rise for our final hymn or song.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness door through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living home. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
And all the people said, amen. Amen.
I know. Well, to be fair, I was trying because I was like, no, I think I might be able to do it. And then I was like, yeah. And then, like, halfway through, I was like, well, I was trying to sing away from the mic. So I was trying to sing over here, and then she cranked it as I moved over here.
Yeah, well, that's what I needed.
So, like, I was doing like this, and then I moved over, and she had me.
Drop the harmony, and then you just didn't sing the next chorus, and I was like, I know, I was like, all right, nope.